Here at home, encouraging news this morning as the nation tries to fight the Delta-fueled COVID surge. Johnson & Johnson says that its preliminary data show that people who received booster doses of its one-shot COVID-19 vaccine had a big spike in antibodies. CNN senior medical correspondent Elizabeth Cohen has been looking at the data here. This is important because it shows that not only one vaccine, if you get that booster, you can really boost your immunity to this.
That's right. Let's go over a little bit what the Johnson & Johnson vaccine is. It's been a while, I think, since we've spoken about it. So Johnson & Johnson has been called the one-shot wonder. You only need one shot. But remember, in their clinical trials, it was 66% effective against moderate and severe COVID. Good, but not as good as the other two vaccines that at that time were more around 95%. So let's take a look at what this study did. It was a small study. What they did is they gave everyone one shot, waited 6 months later, and antibodies increased ninefold. In other words, from the one shot, about 28 days later, antibodies reached a certain level. But when they waited 28 days after the second shot, antibodies increased nine times where they were shortly after that first shot. That really is saying something. Now, Jim, I'll add here that one-shot wonder, you know, several public health experts who we've talked to said it didn't quite work out that way. Only 14 million Americans have received Johnson & Johnson. Compare that, say, to Pfizer, which is nearly 100 million. Johnson & Johnson was supposed to be a vaccine that would be used around the world. One shot, doesn't need to be kept at these really cold temperatures. It hasn't quite worked out that way. We'll see if this changes anything.
For sure. Listen, options are good. Just got to get more people vaccinated. Okay, let's talk about children. Cases in children, of course, can't be vaccinated unless they're above 12 and above, are now reaching levels we haven't seen in months. Where is that and where is it expected to go? Because we're not even into wintertime and most kids aren't back at school yet.
That's right. So these numbers are really quite alarming. Let's take a look at what has happened even just over the course of the summer. If you take a look at the week of August 12th, there were about 180,000 new cases among children. Compare that to the week of July 15th, not even a month before, only 38,000 new cases in that week. That really tells you something. Now, some people might look at these numbers and say, oh, does it really matter? Children, you know, a tiny percentage of them end up in the hospital or end up dying. That is true, but the more cases you have, the more hospitalized children you're going to have, the more dead children you're going to have. And as Dr. Rochelle Walensky, the head of the CDC, put it to a member of Congress, children are not supposed to die. You shouldn't even have one child dead from this virus. So it is worth trying to get these numbers down.
Elizabeth Cohen, thanks very much. Let's speak more with Dr. Carlos Del Rio. He's the Executive Associate Dean of the Emory University School of Medicine at Grady Health System. Dr. Del Rio, always good to have you on. Help us understand what we're learning here about children. Listen, I've got two kids below the age of 12, not vaccinated. I don't want them to get infected, certainly, but I do look at the data and I know that's a very small percentage of children who get severe disease. How should parents view this? Should they view this as a moment to take reasonable precautions? Wear a mask in school, for instance. Watch for news of approval for a vaccine for 12 and under? Or do they need to look at this, in your view, with more concern?
Jim, I would think about it the way you would think, for example, about letting your kids walk to school or, you know, drive their bike to school. You want to, you know, allow them to do that, but you want to do it in the safest possible way, right? You want to put a helmet on them. You want to tell them when to cross the street, et cetera. I would think about it the same way. The best way to protect children that are yet not candidates to be vaccinated, those 12 and under, are to do two things. Number one, to have all the adults around them vaccinated. Anybody over the age of 16 around them should be vaccinated. And number two, we need to make sure that everybody who's with them and those kids are also wearing a mask. And that's why I just, you know, baffles me that we have had so many controversies about masking in schools, because if I had kids that age and I was sending them to school, I would want them masked, and I would also ask their teachers and anybody who's with them to also be masked. Yeah. Trying to decrease the risk of those kids is critically important.
I'm with you. I mean, the idea that people, either for politics or not understanding the science or refusing to mask or get vaccinated themselves, putting kids who can't be vaccinated at risk just blows my mind. Let's talk about the news about the J&J booster, because the J&J shot, it's a small percentage of the many hundreds of millions of doses now put out, Pfizer and Moderna in this country, you know, far in the lead. That's it. It's important. It's one shot. Should this give us some encouragement here? Because now you have another option with the booster that reliably, according to the data, fights back against the Delta variant?
Well, you know, Jim, let me start by saying that we have no clinical evidence that you're seeing more failures with J&J than with the other vaccines. So I think we're jumping a premature conclusion. We really have no data saying those that got J&J are getting hospitalized a lot more than people that got Pfizer or Moderna. The protection is about the same, and I would not, I'm not very concerned about that. What we see in the study is an increase in antibodies, but again, we need studies that tell us that that increase in antibodies translates in better protection against, you know, infection and to decrease hospitalizations and death. And the clinical outcomes data is simply not there. So this is encouraging news, but again, I would be very careful about making the leap of faith saying because of this, therefore that means it's going to be protective.
It's okay, fair enough. It's a smart point. Listen, and by the way, having options is good, no question. Final question, if I can. We have a lot of concerning data about what the Delta variant is doing, particularly in states with low vaccination rates. We have some better news, though, right, where we see the daily average of vaccinations tweaking up, that kind of thing. We see a lot of school districts requiring masks, as the public health guidance is. Are you seeing any data that gives you an indication that the country is responding to the Delta surge in a way that should encourage us? I'm not saying the threat is gone. You get my point, though, here. Are there signs that we're getting a handle on this?
Well, you know, without doubt, we're seeing more and more people vaccinated. But again, the people vaccinated today are not going to be protected until 6 weeks from now. So it's going to take some time. But I think people are taking Delta seriously. I think people are starting to realize that this is something that they need to be concerned about. I am hoping that as a result of that, we're starting to see maybe a little flattening of the curve of, you know, Delta increases in some places. Even Florida is beginning to see a little bit of a flattening, which may be an encouraging news. The reality is that Delta is bad. And I want to reassure people that if you've been vaccinated, you really are in good shape. Even with the lower protection against infection from Delta, there may be breakthrough cases, but you're unlikely to be hospitalized or death. Yeah. The problem is people that are not vaccinated. And if I was not vaccinated, I would really be scared about this strain. This is really highly transmissible, and you can end up being very sick. And I can tell you, we have our hospitals full of people who have not been vaccinated, who are in the ICU, who are in ventilators. And this is really, this is the tragedy, right?
The the data shows that the vast majority of folks getting sick or hospitalized are the unvaccinated. Dr. Carlos Del Rio, thanks very much.
Happy to be with you.